And if you have your Bibles, I'd like you to open up to 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 58. If you don't have a Bible, it's going to be on the overhead. You can check it out. So we want to get right into the verse and look at what it says to us this morning. Let's read this. It says in 1 Corinthians, "Therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that you toil is not in vain in the Lord." Let's just pray. God, we thank you. God, we ask you that you would move this morning in this service. And God, we thank you that you are going to minister and touch us and help us, God. And God, we pray, God, that you would speak to our lives, Father, and we give you all the praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, this verse is specifically trying to tell us something. If you guys could maybe check there's a little ringing in the monitors. And as you look at this verse, it's kind of getting right down to the meat of the matter, because there are times in our lives that we think or we feel that the things that we do for the Lord is in vain. We help someone. We tell a person about Jesus. We pray for a friend or a coworker. And sometimes it feels like it doesn't really matter. Like what we're doing is not working. That it's not effective. And we can feel that some of the things that we do for Jesus are pointless. We pray for that person and nothing happens. We try to minister to someone and it seems fruitless. And it becomes very easy for us to think that our labors or our toil are in vain. Have you feel that way? We all do. And we look at that. We even look at our church's mission to save, to serve, and to send. And we think, you know, what's the point? My labor, my toil doesn't matter. It's all in vain. But I want to share with you about three people from my trip down to Mexico. These are real people. These are people that I met and was with that showed me and hopefully will show you that what we do for Jesus is not in vain. It's not useless. It's not worthless. But it has tremendous value, what we do for God. The first person I want to mention this morning is actually two people. It's a young mother and her little son. When we went into Mexico, we went into this one area. They showed some pictures of it. It's hard to even comprehend, even in a picture. You have to be there to really experience it. But it's probably the poorest place I've ever been to. And you got to understand, I've been all over the world. I've been in Africa. You know, I've been in India. You know, I lived in Fiji, some very poor places. But this is probably the poorest place I've ever been to. And as you go there, you look at the houses. A lot of the houses are made out of pieces of pallets, from the wood from the pallets. And they have plastic for a roof or even the size of the house. And we went there to give out, food and clothing and toiletries and other items because these people are so poor that like a loaf of bread is like very valuable to them. And one of the ladies from our church, she handmade 75 items of clothing to take down there, for us to take down. I mentioned this a couple weeks ago. Now, you got to realize, she didn't go to Walmart and buy these. She handmade these. And there was this one particular thing that she made that was real special to me. She made this little baby blanket and it looked like a football. This is a cool thing, man. I liked it. And I didn't even know it, but it even had a little hat, like a little football hat for it too, man. It was a pretty cool little outfit. And it was very special to me. And I wanted to make sure that the right person got that item. You know, and so we're there and we're going and we're handing out food and, you know, we're giving out toiletries. And I was praying to God. I said, God, I want to make sure the right person gets this item. I really did. I prayed that. And then God showed me this little dude, man, this little guy. And I want to show you his picture. If you guys could put the picture up. Now, the one before that, it's the one before that. There he is. I don't know why it's not coming up clear. But he's just this cute little dude, man. I mean, he's adorable. And, you know, two, I think I liked him because we kind of had the same kind of haircut, you know? You know, he's my bald brother, man. You know, we got to stick together. And I saw this little guy, and my heart just went out to him. But what happened was we're kind of right in the middle of passing out all these items, and it was so crazy. I mean, you're there, and all the stuff is, you know, happening, and it's just pretty chaotic. And I told one of the guys who spoke Spanish, I told him, I go, talk to that young mother and tell her I have something special for her. And when everything calmed down, I went to that young mother, and I gave her the blanket and the hat. And then you could show the next picture. Here it is. I'm giving it to him. Little football blanket and then a little football hat. And you can't hardly see it in there. I don't know why the pictures aren't clear. But the little dude is looking up at me, you know. And he's probably thinking, cool gringo, man. That's what he's probably thinking, you know. And I gave that to them. And then we proceeded to do some other things. We're giving things out. And then the outreach was winding down, and most of the people had gotten their items, and they had left. And then something powerful happened. That mother that I gave those items to, she found me, and she came up to me, and she said these two potent words. And she said them in English. Now, you got to understand, this lady doesn't speak English. She's totally Spanish speaking, but she came up to me and she said in English, she said, thank you. And these words really hit me. It showed me the gratitude that she had. You could see it in her eyes. And she meant this. And she really meant it when she said, thank you. Thank you for helping my family. Thank you for caring about us. Thank you for even thinking about my son. And I want everyone to remember those two words because I'm going to come back to them at the end of this sermon. But those two words tell me that our labor is not in vain. It's not in vain. We do have impact when we do things for God. Us going all the way down to Mexico, and you know, and you hear all the good stories about what happened, but you know, there were some hardships, just traveling. I mean, sometimes very little sleep. The last day we were there, I mean, it was a crazy day. You know, you're in the blazing hot sun and doing all these things, but you know what? It's worth it. It's worth it. It's not in vain. And as that young mother walked away, I was watching her walk away, and then I turned, and I was looking in the opposite direction, and I saw the coolest thing, man. It was so cool. There was about like 8 little kids. All little, maybe from 3 years old to maybe about 6. And they're walking down this dirt road where all these houses are. And all of them have these knitted hats on. They're all colorful hats, too. I mean, they're all bright colors, and they have them on. And they're walking down the road. And you got to understand, it's about 105 degrees out. And they got these knit hats on. You know, and they're walking, and the kids are just real proud. They're like, they're walking. They're like the knit hat gang or something. And I'm like, yeah, but we got our hats on. And they're walking down the road, and they're so happy to have their hats. And then someone told me this that I didn't even realize, is that those kids are going to need those hats when winter comes, because in that area, it will get below zero. Now think about this. They're living in a place, the roof is plastic. Plastic. I don't even know how they survive in the winter. It's bad enough in the summer. And so our toil is not in vain. Your labor is not pointless, because there are people that are thankful and grateful for what we do for them. That's the first person. The second person I want to talk to about is a guy named Philip or Philippi. Actually, you saw some of the pictures of him from Brandy. In Luke chapter 19, verse 10, it says, "For the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost." You know, Jesus came to save people that were far away from God. And even though all of us were far away from God, some people seem a lot further than others, don't they? And when we met this man, Philip, in Mexico, you could look at him and say, you know what, he was a guy that was very far away from God. And I want to show a picture of him. You know, Brandy showed one. I don't know why they're not coming up clear, but that's Philip. And it's hard to see in that picture because it's not clear, but Philip has tattoos all over his face. And they're not there to try to look cool, because I know some people, they get tattoos, you know, to express themselves, but his tattoos are there to identify with himself, with his gang, and his vatio. That's why they're there. And Philip told me that he was in Los Angeles. And he was from a place called Southgate, which I know of very, very well. It's a very rough place. And I told him I used to pastor in Los Angeles in the San Pedro area. And immediately he told me the name of our main gang. He knew that. It was kind of crazy that he knew that. And so as I'm talking to him, I find out that he was heavily involved in his gang, and he was also into drugs and crime, and he was arrested, and they actually gave him 40 to life. And he didn't tell me what he did, but let me tell you something. There's not too many things you can do to get 40 to life. You guys know what I'm talking about. But what happened was Philip was a Mexican citizen, and the California prisons are totally packed out. So they offered Philip voluntary deportation to go back to Mexico, and he took it, which I don't blame him. I would have too. What do you want to do, go to Mexico or spend in jail the rest of your life? Oh, I think I'll take Mexico. And he went to Mexico. And one of the pastors from one of our churches met up with him and witnessed to Philip. And Philip gave his life to Jesus, man. Hallelujah. Praise God. And now he's serving the living God instead of serving some gang. Now he's doing something for God instead of crime. And see, that makes us understand that our labor is not in vain, because there's people like Philip that are coming to Jesus. And to me, that's awesome. People that are far away from God giving their lives to Jesus Christ and changing. And because of what we do, people are changing. Isn't that worth it, just that? Just to see one person like that change? Isn't it worth it to see anyone change? It's worth it. Our labors are not in vain when we see God do miracles like that, man. It's not. It's worth it, man. When you see something like that. You know, I saw this thing that Philip wrote. And he wrote and he said this. He said, "If God can change me, He can change anyone." He knows what God has done. And see, we need to know that what we do for God, it matters. The third person I want to mention today is a man named Jim. Jim, at one time, was one of my best friends. When I pastored in Los Angeles, he pastored in a city right next to mine, a place called Long Beach, California. And we were very close friends. We did everything together. Our families did stuff together. You know, our kids hung out. Our churches did events together. We used to have like revivals and crusades and outreaches all together. And Jim had a powerful ministry, and he was an awesome preacher. But what happened was, when I was on my way to being a missionary to the nation of Fiji, Jim was struggling with some personal issues. And he ended up giving up his church, and he ended up moving back to his home state of New York. And me being in a foreign country before the internet, you got to understand, Fiji did not get the internet till the year 2000. That's how behind they were. You know, so it wasn't around. And especially because Jim went off the radar, he kind of went off the grid. I totally lost track of Jim. And over the years, I would hear different kind of stories about him, like that he had backslidden and he wasn't doing well. He wasn't serving God anymore. And I like to say that I prayed for him every day, you know, but I didn't. But occasionally I would, and I'd say, God, you know, touch Jim wherever he's at, you know, work in his life. And for 16 years, I never heard one word from Jim. And then about 2 years ago, I get this phone call out of the blue, and it's Jim. And he proceeded to tell me, you know, where he had been for the last 16 years. And he told me how he fell away from God, how he got involved with alcohol and drugs, that he even started bartending, and he was arrested 3 times. And he was very fortunate that he didn't spend a lot of years in jail. And how his life unraveled after he walked away from God. But then he told me about a year prior, so this is 3 years ago, he got his heart right with God and he started to live for Jesus again. Amen. And over the last 2 years or so, we would talk on the phone and we'd be talking about different stuff. And I would encourage him. I'd say, Jim, you know what? God's not done with you yet, man. God's not done with you. God could still use you. And I would talk to him and I would encourage him that God wanted to still use his life. And finally, I invited him, why don't you come to Mexico with us? And I'll try to work it out where you can preach down there. And when he came to Mexico, when I actually saw him, I remember coming into Pastor Lalo's house, and I saw Jim. It's the first time I've seen him in 18 years. I haven't seen him. One of my best friends hadn't seen him in 18 years. And, you know, I hugged him, and then we started talking, and he told me what happened. And he said God had been stirring him to preach again, but there wasn't any open doors. He said there's no opportunities. He's in a big church, about 3,000 people, and there's just no opportunities to preach. But then one night, check this out, okay? So what he told me. One night he had a dream, and he was standing in this room, and I walked into the room. This is his dream. And I said, Jim, they're all waiting for you. And he said, waiting for me for what? And I said, they're waiting for you to preach. And then the dream was over. And then 2 weeks later, I called him and asked him to come to Mexico. And he came. And for the first time in 18 years, Jim preached. Hallelujah. Praise God. In 1 Thessalonians 5:11, it tells us this. Therefore, encourage one another and build up one another, just as you also are doing. See, my prayers for Jim were not in vain. My encouragement to him meant something. And here's a man that hadn't preached in 18 years. And I had a little part in helping him to find his way. And so we need to all realize that our labor is not in vain. That person you encourage, it's valuable. The prayers you say for others are extremely important. The love that you demonstrate to people can do things beyond your wildest comprehension. Because all our toil, all our labor is not in vain. You know, as we close this sermon this morning, I want to play a short video of a song. Years ago, this song was very popular, and maybe some of you have heard it or seen it, but some of you probably have not. And I want to play this song, if you guys could.
I dreamed I went to heaven, and you were there with me. We walked upon the streets of gold beside the crystal sea. We heard these angels singing, and someone called your name. You turned and saw this young man. He was smiling as he came. And he said, friend, you may not know me now. Then he said, but wait. You used to teach my Sunday school when I was only 8. And every week you would say a prayer before the class would start. One day when you said that prayer, I asked Jesus in my heart. So thank you for giving to the Lord. 'Cause I am a life that was changed. So glad you gave. Then another man stood before you, said, remember the time a missionary came to your church and his pictures made you cry. You didn't have much money, but you gave it anyway. Jesus took the gift you gave, and that's why I'm in heaven today. And he said, thank you for giving to the Lord.
Good news. I have good news for you.
The
good news is God loves you. He has a plan for your life. There's a purpose for living. There's a reason for existence. Don't give up. Don't let the headlines frighten you. God is still sovereign. He's still on the throne. And those of us that follow him and serve him have a future that's brighter than tomorrow.
One by one they came, far as your eyes could see. Each life somehow touched by your generosity. Little things that you had done, sacrifices you made, well, they were unnoticed on the earth. And heaven now proclaim. And I know up in heaven, they say you're not supposed to cry, but I'm almost sure I saw tears in your eyes as Jesus took your hand and you stood before the Lord. He said, my child, look around you. Great is your reward. Thank you for giving to the Lord. 'Cause I am a life that was changed. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am so glad you gave. Oh, thank you for giving to the Lord. I am a life that was changed. So glad you came. I am so glad you
an awesome song, isn't it? You know, there's a line in that song. It says, unnoticed down on earth, but heaven now proclaims. See, many things we can do down on this earth that can go unnoticed, that seem insignificant, that seem that they're not important, but they are. Because one day, we'll get to heaven and we'll see what we've done, the impact that it's made. Because I'm here to tell you this morning, our labor is not in vain. Our toil, our work, what we do, our love, the help and the prayers that we do for others, it makes a big difference. And sometimes we don't know that. Sometimes we find out. Sometimes it's a thank you. Sometimes it's just someone, you see their life change and you see things that happen because of what you've done. But I'm here to tell you, our labor is not in vain. I'd like you to bow your heads this morning, if you could, all across this place.